Top of the Hill will be seen next Thursday at its usual time.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to request a brief recess.
Now, get ready for a CBS special, Women of the 21st Century, next.
I guess you could call me an explorer. As a magazine writer, I explore for facts, and sometimes I even find the truth. What I found on this assignment is another explorer, a woman who is hot on the trail of a target that has eluded mankind for centuries, the Fountain of Youth. Rachel McLish is only 30, but she is charting a new course to the secret of youth, and it ties right in with my story. The worldwide explosion of female dedication to the physical life. Rachel is that rare combination of brains and beauty. Not only was she the world female bodybuilding champion 4 times, but she has written 2 best-selling books on physical fitness. And one of them is being used by West Point as a training manual. Fitness experts will tell you that Rachel alone is responsible for getting about 20 million women involved in weight training. She seemed to be the perfect focus for my story, Woman of the 21st Century. I think she represents what more and more women will be like in that not-too-distant future. To make sure, I spent a solid week dogging Rachel's rapid footsteps. And for an aging reporter, that wasn't easy. Poetry in motion is a pretty well-worn cliche. But after watching Rachel on that first day, I sure couldn't come up with anything that says it better.
Living inside the imagination.
Exhibition of strength and power. And it's not all just for show. I was, in fact, about to see a rather shattering practical application. I was also about to be scared out of my wits. Chinatown at night is always a little mysterious. And for a while, I thought my story was about to wind up on the front page.
We have to admit it was good.
I don't know what we can do next weekend.
What?
We can go skiing. Have you tried that?
Oh, I don't want to go skiing. Last time I went skiing, I broke my leg.
How about playing tennis? You can't break your leg doing that.
You're not going to believe this. Last time I played tennis, I had to wear a patch on my eye for 3 weeks.
Oh, God. Cynthia, I've got to get you out of the house somehow. Your books and your classes. You've got to get out and enjoy yourself. I don't know what it is with you.
I don't know. I guess I'm just physically hopeless.
I was soon to learn that Cynthia isn't quite the hopeless female she's making herself out to be.
You have to go in there.
I know.
What about these little
animal things or whatever? Animal. I know what these are. These are like for Chinese New Year's for dragon dance. You know, you actually put those on. Let's go inside.
That's crazy.
I know. Oh, I love these shops. God, look at this stuff.
Oh, I go wild in here. What?
Rachel and Cynthia haven't noticed these guys, but there's something about them.
The only man in the place who knows what he's doing. He doesn't look so happy. Yeah, well, check this one out.
That's crazy.
Here, we'll take about 10. These things are pretty neat, these wood carvings here.
I have a feeling that these guys might be more interested in nonsense than they are in incense.
Your love life will be happy and harmonious.
Oh, gosh, why can't mine say that?
Well, I think I'll keep this one. That's not bad.
Oh, is that a wishing well up there?
Yeah, let's go over and make a wish.
Okay.
I put in a lot of years as a reporter, and every gut instinct tells me I'm absolutely right about those guys. I don't like it one bit.
What? They would put the well way back there. That's not so bad of a shot.
Oh, yeah, it lands in the water.
I also don't like the fact that the girls didn't even notice those guys. Women should be more aware of things like this, especially at night. What makes me really nervous is the FBI report I saw at the news desk the other day. It says there were 90,430 forcible rapes in America last year. 10 every hour.
I didn't see one penny inside anyone's dishes.
Oh, it's getting chilly out here.
That means that 10 women will be raped while I'm telling you this story. I hope we're not about to see a couple of new statistics right here.
How many fresh cookies did you eat? Oh, in
Cynthia, I must have left them back there. I'll be right back. It'll only take a second.
Okay, hurry up.
Hey, babe, what's up?
Hey, guys, leave me alone, okay?
We're not here to bother you. Good. We're not here to bother you.
Please.
Just wait. We got something to
say. My friends are up there. They're waiting for me. They're all there. They're looking.
This is what I was afraid of. Cynthia has one little secret. She's a black belt in karate and 5-time undefeated female world champion.
See, you want to play, huh? Big mistake, babe. You gotta pay. You just gotta pay a little.
A woman's leg is her greatest weapon, and this is why. A single muscle fiber, one of thousands in each muscle, contracts explosively. And when thousands do it together, the force generated is awesome. The muscle power behind that kick is delivering over 1 ton of force. The tendons, which connect the muscle to the bone, can be stronger than the bone itself, especially in the leg. And when these tendons contract, they can sling the bones forward like a catapult, generating terrific force. And because the foot bone is one of the strongest, a skillful karate kick can easily smash a rib cage. Clearly, Cynthia is still the undefeated champ. I've got a feeling that the average woman shouldn't take on three armed punks in a dark alley, even if she knows karate. But what I learned from my article is that one reason more and more women are learning self-defense is that it cuts way down on their chances of becoming one of those ugly FBI statistics.
Found them.
Lisa, out of breath.
Out of breath? I ran all the way back. I realize this is not the best neighborhood in the world.
Yeah.
You mind driving? I've had a rough night.
Cynthia was remarkable, all right. But the next day, I was about to meet some women who were downright shocking. I was learning that the physical life can take many forms. For these women, it's an all-consuming passion.
Sometimes that scares men.
Some of the guys don't like it. They think we're trying to be men. Oh, my God. Who'd want to be a man? Who'd want to be a man?
When I got to the gym, there were a lot of women in here who looked like guys. And it was really depressing. And it scared me. It scared me a lot.
I feel totally feminine.
In fact, I feel more feminine now than I've ever felt in my life. Because my body's shapely, and it's hard as a rock. Nothing jiggles.
I don't believe there's any limits. Part of the fun is to come into the gym and see how far you can take yourself.
Quit training? I'll never quit training. Training is sex. Would you quit sex?
I get a high off of pumping weight. Something you do forever.
It's just something to a woman. My back is wide and here it tapers in to a nice hip structure, like finely shaped glutes. It's the fact that when you begin to work glutes, you get a nice shape to them. Somehow they're firm. They stand up instead of sagging.
I don't like biceps, though. But you know what? Some men think it's better than your breast. So, bodybuilding women get to have four breasts. Lucky us, huh?
Occasionally I feel out of place. Occasionally I feel kind of freaky. You know, when you get dressed up into some evening attire, sometimes sometimes I feel somewhat less attractive.
My husband felt threatened by the bodybuilding. There was a lot of time involved in the gym, time away from the children, and I was around a lot of men, and I think that it was very threatening for him.
My husband's into weight training. He's the one that got me involved in it some 3.5 years ago. He was spending a lot of time at the gym, and I decided to join him rather than stay home by myself.
I kept reading all these magazines, and especially one by Rachel McLish. And I really liked her physique. I thought it was real pretty, sexy. And she was a very feminine lady. She didn't look like a guy.
Wait till you see the women that are coming out of this generation. My motto is get ready to take over the world.
When I was competing, I spent a lot of time training here. It was a nice surprise to see that some of my old pals were still so into it.
There's God! Great to live! I thought you were just playing tennis. Because obviously the girl's still in shape.
All I know is I'm glad I don't have to compete anymore.
You were the first. You were the first to have a two-part bicep to split. Do you still have it? Oh my God.
Oh God.
All right. Well, that's good, Rachel. Because you're still it. You're still there. No one can replicate your style. One of a kind remains so.
Tough workouts, if you do them right, are the best way to keep your body looking young.
The thing is to squeeze and contract all you've got.
It hurts so good. You do it.
I'd rather deadlift.
You'd rather deadlift?
Yes.
Okay, this way?
Yeah.
This way?
Great, that's right. Good. That's it.
That's it.
Stand your legs straight when you go back. To really squeeze it.
Oh, ow.
This is what's going to give you the shape and the tightness.
Think so?
Burn off lots of calories, too.
I'll do it. How many more?
That's it. Just keep strict form, okay? Wait.
I'm cramping.
Okay, on three. Ready? Up.
In bodybuilding, like many other sports today, the issue of steroids casts an ugly shadow.
Slow it down, Mimi.
Those who won't use them can't always compete on an equal level. But the short-term gains are hardly worth the long-term side effects.
Hey, what's wrong? Okay, break. Break.
It's hard. You don't throw the weights at the end of the set, man. You've got a lot of weight for that movement. You can break your back,
you know,
and then you'll wreck everything, and then what?
Just sometimes, I mean, here we are training, working our butts off, and some people in training get up there faster.
It's like you train hard, you work hard. I come in here at 5 in the morning, I sweat, go to school, go to work, come back and sweat. It's my whole life. I mean, there's no social life, there's no anything, and people can come in here, and you know they're on steroids. They don't even train, unless they hire for months. Months, if I don't train for 1 week, I'm loose, you know that. You've got to just keep going at it, and it just, it's painful. It hurts.
One thing is medical fact. If Mimi were using steroids, she would be hurting a lot more. Anabolic steroids are a form of the hormone called testosterone. That's the stuff that turns boys into men. Unfortunately for women, it does the same things to them. Mustaches and beards begin to appear. Facial features become enlarged. Body hair begins to increase, and the voice becomes deeper. There is mounting medical evidence that using these steroids can lead to severe mental and emotional problems. They can cause cancer of the liver and kidneys. They raise blood pressure, and they can clog the arteries, increasing the chances for a heart attack. The damage the steroids can cause is irreversible. It's permanent. And the ultimate side effect is death.
Nobody can take this away from you, what you've worked for, the character you've built, and you have to sleep in your own skin every single night.
That's true.
Knowing that you're not destroying your body. Being a champion isn't winning a title with steroids.
Yeah.
I want a picture out of this. I'm sorry, Rachel.
I know,
come
you
on.
Never
you
hate
your hair.
Well, as I said, some of these women are pretty startling indeed. Rachel McLish was proving to be the ideal guide for my journey through the world of feminine physicality. After our next stop, there would be no doubt whatsoever. Of all the very special women I was to meet on this assignment, none affected me more than this odd but troubled young girl named Heather. Heather is only 12 years old, but she's already a writer's dream. The kid is both a champion and a victim. She's a world-class gymnast, but Heather has been training ever since she was 5 years old. And as soon as her potential became clear, proud parents, fawning friends, and caring coaches stuffed her into a pressure cooker filled with love and hope and expectation. A tender trap, perhaps, but a pressure cooker just the same. And now Heather is a kid on the edge. She's on the brink of burnout. Rachel McLish is a proven champion. She's been through it all. And when Heather's parents turned to Rachel for help, she responded by setting up a gym in her own home.
Glad to see you.
Yes, great gym. Great.
You're not putting me on, are you?
No, it's great. shoulders and stuff and look up and stretch.
Big turtle all the way.
You always know if you stretch really hard the next day, you always regret it. It's just like, oh my gosh, why did I do this? And then 2 days later, it's all better and you get farther down.
Every young girl approaching her teens has such a fragile psyche. And for someone like Heather, it's even worse.
Yeah.
If she makes the Olympic team and goes to Barcelona in 1992, Heather will only be 15. But most gymnasts are over the hill by the time they're old enough to vote. So if she's going to make her mark, she has got to do it now.
I'm gonna hold it for a few seconds. Press against my hand again. Okay, relax. See?
It's really neat that I'm going to be working with you for the next 4 years.
The pressure is as much mental and emotional as it is physical, and that's what leads to burnout. Heather is fully aware of the pressures that she is facing, and I wanted her to talk about it. I think that really helps.
A lot of kids burn out because either the coach works them too hard and just, you know, bangs on them and stuff. And then another things are they just get tired of it. They go to school, they have friends. I mean, I've been in a coach's office ready to quit before.
Sometimes, in the effort to have someone like Heather do her best, coaches and even parents can lose sight of just how fragile a young girl can be. I know this from my own experiences, and that's all a part of what causes burnout. I feel that one of the answers is learning how to pace yourself. Heather has to work really hard if she's to fulfill that brilliant potential of hers. But she also has to have time to fill the needs that all girls her age have. And right now, it's time for some of that positive encouragement.
Heather, I just want to say a couple of things to you because I know in the years to come, you're going to be working really hard. I know how you're committed and how much effort and energy and your heart is into what you do. Just be prepared that it doesn't always turn out the way you'd like it to. Okay, you're like a little baby sister to me, and I just want you to be happy and get what you want, okay? Let's do it, right? Okay.
Just one look and you can tell this kid really has the talent. Her form, her style, her timing are all world class. But there is a problem. And that's it. Heather's bar routine is terrific, but she can't seem to finish on her feet. It's what gymnasts call sticking a landing. Physically, it shouldn't be a problem for Heather at all. The problem is in her head. She can't seem to overcome stress under pressure. And that is a clear-cut symptom of burnout.
It would be so easy to critique Heather right now. But I think there comes a time, especially with a child, when criticism becomes counterproductive. After a certain point, a person might just give up. And for someone with Heather's potential, that would be heartbreaking.
Heather, you want to talk about it? What's up?
Can't do it right. Won't go. Can't do anything right.
Come on, I don't believe that for a second.
Every time I do my dismount plan, I fall. I can't stick it, I can't even make it. I can't keep tight, and my body just falls apart. I can't keep going, I can't keep my feet off the ground. I can't do it right.
I don't believe what I'm hearing. Sounds like negative thinking to me.
I do everything right. I try my best. I give it all I can. I can't do it. It just doesn't go.
I think I've got just the thing that's going to make you stick that landing. Come with me. Got just the thing.
McLish was about to turn the desert into an intensive care unit for burnout.
Sometimes it's just good to just stop what you're doing, no matter what it is, good day or bad day, and just take a break. Go outside and do something totally that makes you just feel good.
It's long been said that laughter is the best medicine. And right now, it seems that Rachel knows that a few good chuckles are just what the kid needs.
Perfect. Perfect.
Oh, suit yourself. Let me see. Hey, Heather, you know what a lowrider is?
What's a lowrider?
You don't know what a lowrider is, man? Hey, man, a lowrider is when you drive around in a really cool car, real low to the ground, and you can kind of cruise the boulevard looking for nickels on the street. You know, the main thing is to look cool in your vehicle, man. You're like this. Cruising the boulevard, man.
Can't look too serious.
Hey, man, it is serious business when you're trying to cruise for the dudes or for the chicks, man. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah. Sure.
Sometimes, whether you're a potential champion like Heather or just trying to keep in shape, it might seem that keeping fit is all work and no play. And that kind of thinking is the start of burnout. Actually, nothing could be further from the truth. And that's why Heather is here. To get out, to have fun, to get rid of her worries, to burn out her burnout.
This might be a dangerous stunt, but there was a method to Rachel's madness in climbing this mountain barefoot. And at least Rachel knows what she's doing up there. Someone who's not experienced at this is more likely to end up 6 feet under than 400 feet up. And Rachel isn't exactly home free yet herself. Right now, she must be getting a pretty good rush of adrenaline. Common knowledge that there's a strong link between adrenaline and the ability to perform under pressure, but for my story, I wanted to learn a bit more about how it ties together. This rare piece of film really laid it out for me. It was shot right inside a living human brain, where that adrenaline is first triggered. When that shock first hits us, the brain sends out a signal to the adrenal glands, which sit right on top of the kidneys. In just an instant, those glands start releasing adrenaline into the bloodstream, and a complex biochemical reaction kicks off some startling changes. Our hearts start pumping at top speed. Our breathing rate increases dramatically, adding more energy-giving oxygen to our bodies. Our muscles gain strength, they begin to contract, and our minds become incredibly alert. A superior athlete like Rachel puts it all together.
I hope Heather gets a point of all this. One way to beat burnout is to set up a challenge for yourself and then meet it.
Hey, Heather! I'll meet you down on the other side! Shabby, huh?
Yeah, I always worked out like this. It's so fun.
I just want you to remember this feeling, okay? Mm-hmm. Because when the going gets really tough, you quit what you're doing and you come and play and have a good time. Mm-hmm. Oh, you're so sweet. So you ready to go and stick that landing?
Yeah.